proper and improper. We'll talk about those. We're going to take a universal set and some of the subsets to find complements, intersections, and unions. That's not hard. We're going to draw Venn diagrams to illustrate sets. If you were fans of Venn diagrams back in chapter 1, you're going to love today and next Tuesday. If you weren't, then I apologize now. Because you're going to see Venn diagrams. You're going to get some today, and then we're doing applications of Venn diagrams next Tuesday. And then we're going to use this thing called the cardinal number formula. And then we have this whole slew of vocabulary, which we're going to hit one piece at a time. Let's start with sets. What is a set? I bet you guys can tell me essentially what a set is. Anybody? Set could be numbers or letters. A group of something. A group of something sounds pretty good. That's a nice way to think about it. It's a group of something. But they have to have something in common so that you can say, yes, this thing is in the group, or no, this thing is not. In our case, yes, this thing is in the set, or no, this thing is not. So for instance, all of you in here make up a set, well, with the exception of Ben and me, all of you who are paying to take this class make up a set of students at ASU who are in Math 142 at noon on Thursdays and Tuesdays with Jones. If I grab some random person off the sidewalk out there and say, is this person in that set? Would you be able to tell me yes? Would it be possible to determine if they were in this class or not? Yes. Some way, for instance, you could come ask me, and I could check their name on the roster, and it'd be yes or no. So that's a set. Essentially, all a set can tell you, though, is yes, something is in me, or no, it is not. It cannot tell you things like, oh, there are like five of these things in here. That's not an option. It can only say yes, it's in here, or no, it's not. It can't say, oh, yeah, that's at the end of the set, or in the middle of the set, or over here on the left. None of that. It's just in there or not. So when we write our sets, the order we write things in doesn't matter. We just write it all down. So,
we've got a really good example of that.
Roster notation. Roster notation is one way to write a set. The way roster notation works is you have your set. I'm going to go ahead and make the screen go up. You always start your sets with the set brace. You will need the set brace when you write your sets in WebWork. Y'all know where that is on the keyboard? Somewhere fairly close to the enter button. Yeah, just a little bit above the enter button. In roster notation, you basically just write down everything that's in the set. So let's think. I know there's somebody in here named Liz and Nick and Hua and so on and so forth. I'm not going to write all down 38 of you down if that's okay. But I could list everybody in the set. And in a small enough set, you would go ahead and list them all. You'd use roster notation where you just basically, think about it, it's the roster for the class. Same kind of thing. You just write every one of them down. But what if we're talking about a huge set? Here's a nice large set for you. All the students enrolled at ASU this fall. You guys know how many people that was? About 60,000 people. I think I saw 66. Something ridiculously large. Do you think I'm going to want to write them all down? No. No time, no patience. So instead of writing them all down, I could use something called set builder notation. And the way set builder notation works is I start with my set bracket. And then I pick a variable. It doesn't matter which variable I pick. I'm going to go for S because we're talking about students. But you can pick any variable. And then the next part of set builder notation is a straight line which is read as such that in this is shorthand. You like this shorthand? Such that. So this is the set of S, such that. And then I would describe my set so it's clear what's in it, what's not. In this and then I'm going to close my set with my set wrist. Now, if I grab a random person out of the Phoenix area and I say, is this person in that set or not, would you be able to tell me, or would it be possible to determine if that person is in the set or not, for just some random person? Yeah. Whenever you have a set where it is absolutely clear what's in it and what's not, that set is called well-defined. But you can have some things that people refer to as sets that are not well-defined. And those are things that you and I might differ on what should be in there. Now, there are some problems in the homework. We're going to look at some of the questions where you might decide, I don't know, but we're going to see. So we want to determine if the given sets are well-defined. Yeah. Well-defined means you can definitely decide what's in it and what's not. So let's start with the first set, or the first description we're going to have here. And it is the set of all pink automobiles. Do you think that set is well-defined or not? So some of you are looking at me a little funny. Why? Is pink bothering you? Did you know pink is actually a well-defined color based on a number related to red, green, and blue? The color pink is actually an exact combination of red, green, and blue that somebody knows in his set and said this is pink. So now, what do you say? Set of pink automobiles. Yeah, if they match that color pink, then the set of pink automobiles is a well-defined set. What about this next one, though? The set of all good bands. Yeah, that's an opinion. What you think is good and what I think is good might be a little iffy. It's been a commercial I saw yesterday where this kid's parents are dressed very strangely and calling him after school and saying, come over here, Bobby, let's go home. And he's ignoring them because they're dressed like, you know, strange bands from the early 70s, late 70s maybe, and he's like, no. So that one's not well-defined. What about this one, set of all odd numbers? Yeah, we know what that is. So this is well-defined. What about the set of small numbers? No, if you're Bill Gates, a million might be a small thing. Not to me, I take a million bucks any day. But to us, you know, a dollar might be small, but to some mathematician, something's not small until it's 0.00000. So small numbers is not well-defined. It depends on who you are. Now, with our sets, we have symbols.